All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us today on May 4th. May the Force be with you, of course. I'm so glad you're here to join us with Star Wars Across Generations Part 2, The French Horn in the Star Wars Universe. I am joined with my co-host here. We have Mr. Rafael Enrique Irizarry, who's the Associate Director of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra. Sir, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate it. I'm glad we get to do this again. Kind of crazy how this was supposed to kind of be an idea of a concert a year ago, and hopefully this is the last time we have to be on Zoom for this. But we have an all-star group of people joining us here. I'll go alphabetical order with Mr. David Cooper, who is Principal Horn of the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. David, thank you, sir.
Thank you for having me.
We have Mr. Benito Diaz, who is Principal Horn of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra. Good to see you, sir.
Hello, everybody. Thank you.
We have Ms. Jen Montone, who is Principal of the Philadelphia Orchestra, who is currently in transition here in the ether. Her video will pop up in a moment. We also have Mr. Jeff Nelsen. Is it fair to say you are Principal Horn of the Canadian Brass?
Sure. Principal Last Horn, sure.
All right, we'll go with Principal Horn of Canadian Brass. I'm so glad you're all here. And to celebrate May 4th, I really hope you're all Star Wars fans. A big thanks to Jeff to, you know, kind of getting this all here to be part of this. All right, let's get started here. Let's get started with some music. And Miss Montone, Jen, could you please play for us the Force theme? Thank you so much for doing that. All right, so thank you for kicking this off. There's no greater theme out there, and all, you know, perhaps, you know, arguably in at least film music, than John's Force theme. So my first question to all of you, we'll start off with Jeff first. Star Wars is often cited as having influence with a younger generation of musicians. Did you find yourself influenced by Star Wars or the music of John Williams when you were younger?
Absolutely. I had opera singing, pig farming parents, story for another time. But the opera and the connection to that music and how it, you know, all the motifs and everything was amazing. And I picked the horn because of Empire Strikes Back. The horn on Empire Strikes Back.
Really? That's so cool.
Yeah, that's easy. Yeah.
that's so cool. That's so cool. Jen.
Yeah, the first thing I learned was the, oh no, the Darth Vader theme. That was the first thing I learned on the horn. Never mind. It was all first bell.
That's so cool. Thanks, man. Let's go, Jen, same question for you. Has the music of Star Wars or John's music influenced you younger, being a horn player?
Oh my gosh, absolutely. I mean, I think every kid who hears the movie music to all of his films are always like, once they figure out that there is a thing called a composer and that they write music, it's always like, who wrote this? What is this? So yeah, for me it was the Star Wars that theme that, I mean, I play it on every kiddie show that, you know, I ever possibly have to choose a theme to play something on. But yeah, I mean, it's just the sound, and the recordings are so good. Like, they just sound amazing.
That's cool. All right, Benito, same question to you. Has the music of Star Wars, has that influenced you?
Of course. I still play that melody, the main thing, when we are trying to recruit a student for our school. So I used to play. I used to play that a lot, and sometimes you get some young, student involved to play the horn, because in Puerto Rico many students doesn't know about the horn, you know, like. We don't have a very good music education program in elementary school and middle school, so we had to show the instrument, and I use this theme every time when I show the instrument. So
nice, thank you, sir. David, on to you. Same question: has John's music, or the music of Star Wars, did that kind of influence you anyway, younger as a horn player?
I mean, that's like the reason I play the horn, right? I mean, like to play the Star Wars theme, of course. Yeah. I mean, that's, yeah, listening to those recordings, I was like, I want to do that. But I mean, yeah, of course.
That's really cool. All right, I want to keep this moving along. Maestro Irizarry, you get the next question, sir.
How has that particular moment in the very first Star Wars film touched you as a horn performer? I mean the binary sunset where we hear the horn play the Force theme in C minor. I mean, it's G minor. Did that have an effect on you? Because I think I am the older person in this panel. I'm probably the only one that was present at the moment of creation. I do recall distinctly that even my home teacher at the time was completely taken aback by that particular spot. Do any of you have any recollection of that and what that did for you? Because it did me some good, hopefully.
I think what's so amazing about John Williams' music, and that's such a perfect example of it, is how kind of evocative and emotional those themes can also be. It's like kind of like he writes in leitmotifs, and in the same way as like Wagner, like that's such a heroic thing. And then it can be so poignant and so sort of, it takes you to this wistful, you know, place. Like, yeah, I think it does the heart very good to hear those themes.
And the horn was made to play these long lyrical phrases too. So it's just genius writing. Get to do it.
Am I mistaken, or some of these materials can almost be played in an actual horn? Almost. Because if you go through some of them and you find the key center, they seem, Princess Leia's theme, for example, can almost be played in the natural horn. So it's amazing that the mastery that Maestro has on writing for the instrument and achieving such an idiomatic phrasing for it. Now, I would like to ask you, why do you think the Maestro chose to place so much emphasis on the French horn for these films?
I'll happily take this one. The French horn for me is like the closest to the human voice. And so it expresses a lot of emotions. And I mean, within the range of human emotions, we've got, you know, heroic, we have like, you know, heartfelt, we have, you know, kind of somber, we have happy, joyous. And I think the horn can express all those really well. So within the range of, you know, the French horn, I think it fits really well for the soloistic themes.
And it's just the greatest instrument.
Could we go to that? So I'm just going to skip around a little bit in our schedule here. Jeff, and I know you're also really pressed for time, because you're actually, as much as I like to think, you got really dressed up for this, and I feel really kind of like a slob right now, but you got a show to do. So yeah, to demonstrate how awesome the horn is, could you actually play for us one of the newer themes to the Star Wars universe, which is Ahsoka's theme, which is part of the Star Wars Clone Wars, Star Wars Rebels animated side? Jeff.
Sure.
I want to tag on to that. By the way, bravo, sir, bravo. You definitely give, you know, good justification why the horn is an all-star instrument. But something really neat to that, and we a little bit about this last night, but that part that was not written by John, written by composer Kevin Kiner, but that was originally written for the bass recorder, which then was the same instrument used for the Mandalorian. And I don't want to give this impression that I know all this great detail of stuff. I don't. I literally have the Star Wars encyclopedia behind me. but doing these sessions, you kind of learn kind of pieces later on. But anyway, so although it was initially introduced that way, repeatedly the composer goes back to just giving it to the horn. And they have, you know, they could really, you know, go back to this really unique instrument, but instead it just goes back to the horn again and again and again. Again, I think giving it credence to it is a pretty awesome instrument.
We're used to that. That's actually not that's not interesting to us. We wait for people to learn that that happens all the time. So we're glad you've come to that realization. Happy to be here waiting for the next melody.
If I may briefly interject, it was Robert Schumann that said the French horn is the soul of the orchestra. And I believe we all entirely agree on that. And how about we listen now to Mr. Benito Diaz perform the theme for Yoda in that wondrous key of C major. It's all yours, sir.
Nicely done, nicely done.
Thank you,
Bravo. All right, so, sir, Mr. Irizarry, I believe you have the next question before I have so many exciting questions to ask all these people, because how often do you get to sit with all these all-stars here, and I'm the odd one out. I'm a percussionist. Everyone here is a horn player, but I can read music. But, you know, you guys win the whole transposition stuff.
We feel very lucky to be sitting right in front of percussionists, I gotta say. Keeps us in line, in time.
I like the bass drum.
Yeah, most of my percussion and horn experiences were somehow, you know, my bass drum is on wheels, and somehow like the whole horn section wanted to be on wheels too, and they were just kind of slid over like 5 feet in one direction, and they always have like the best subtle looks about it's too loud. It's just the subtlety is pretty obvious. It's kind of like, yeah. So we just play louder.
I'm sure you feel the same way about us, though.
Yeah, we can get you back. We're pointed that way.
Right. That's why I conduct instead.
I'm really sorry. I got to jump into my sound check here. Happy, happy, happy Star Wars Day. May the 4th be with everybody. And thanks for coming, everybody. Thanks for having me. It's really amazing to be celebrating this music that made us get to play this instrument. It's just amazing. Also, I was wondering, you were going to ask about audition lists and things. We just put our IU audition list for placement at Indiana University. We have 40 horns that audition and get placement every semester, and we put Leia's theme on the next audition. So we're going to have 40 people playing Leia's theme in the next audition.
That's awesome.
Amazing music. Okay. I'm going through all the circles of history. Yeah, thank you. Happy Star Wars Day.
Okay. Thanks, Jeff. Have a great show.
Have a great show. Good luck,
Jeff.
All right, sir, Ricky, you get the next question.
Short, but not technical question. How does it feel to play this music with two of the world's premier ensembles?
Ben?
Oh, well, I mean, in general, I think these fantastic orchestras feel really grateful to be there. You know, I think we find it a great honor and a great responsibility to fill those chairs, and you always kind of want to do them justice. And so there's that part of it. And then also to be able to play this kind of gorgeous music that you kind of grew up hearing and idolizing these performers and everything. It's just, it's a real privilege and such a treat every single time. And I think one of the things that's so amazing about John Williams music is like how it surrounds you, right? Like, it's kind of like you feel like in the orchestra, like you do in the movie theater, where the music is just huge and it's sweeping over you. And it's just so exhilarating. So of course, like getting to do it live with orchestras is amazing in any situation. You get to be inside your own surround sound. Yeah.
I couldn't have said it better. Jen, thank you.
That's Mr. Exactly, Cooper, sir.
That's exactly how I feel. It's a huge privilege and a huge honor. I might add that, you know, John Williams' music isn't any different than anyone else's, right? I think sometimes we think of it as like, this is movie music, and, you know, it's just great music, period. It doesn't matter if it's from an opera or it doesn't matter from a symphony. John Williams' music is just music, and, you know, I treat it as such. I don't like pop's music. So that's how I view it. In the words of Dale Clevenger, John Williams is my Mozart. You know, he has the melodies that everyone knows, that everyone can grasp onto. And, you know, he's a melodic composer. So with that, I'll pass.
Beautifully, beautifully articulated. I heard that someone described that Strauss at the time was, you know, kind of seen as just dance music. And how is it going to really sustain over time? And yet, you know, especially, you know, the music of John Williams and all these great films, we might appreciate it in that moment, but it's definitely, as Mr. Clevenger pointed out, that is going to, I think, withstand the time as he is the Mozart of our time. Yeah, that's cool. I have a question, and then we'll get over to David for Princess Leia's theme. So, and Jeff kind of alluded to this. Part of the question was, do you see this music making its way into the standard repertoire? Obviously, doing things live to picture now, becoming much more common. You don't get as much rehearsal time. You get one, maybe two rehearsals, and then you just go. But aside from that, and it seeming like what Jeff said, that especially on the academic side, it is becoming part of that. On other, for kind of audition rep list, are you finding that themes like this are being added?
I think that we should include that in audition, you know, like, especially for second horn and maybe fourth horn audition, if you play the Yoda's theme, the whole thing, you know, like, you have to play between the middle and low register, and you have to connect every note very, you know, long distance, you know, and then we play in 1 year, 9 months about John Williams music. So Maestro Irizarry can tell you more of that. And you know, it's part of our repertoire today. Many people used to go to the concert because John Williams music, you know, Star Wars music. So we got 9 concerts completely full. That's the magic of John Williams music, you know, like. So we should do that. So for next audition, I'm going to do that, you know. If you are going to play principal, you should play also Princess Leia, you know, theme, because thanks to Maestro Irizarry, I got to play twice. One Sunday, we had to play 2 concerts the same day, and I got to play Princess Leia. And then also Luke and Leia theme, that is my favorite theme, you know, like. So we should do that. That's part of our life, a horn player, you know.
Yeah, Benito, you made a really good point there that more people show up for Star Wars concerts than they do actually, you know, for maybe some of the other, you know, programs, or more as much as our top selling concerts.
Yes.
And on the years where we do like a Mahler symphony, it might be maybe 2 or 3 more years before we do another that symphony again, or another Mahler symphony, depending on which orchestra you're in. And for me, at least, I knew that the Star Wars music would come up at least once a year, if not twice. So really, it's more practical to know, can you play Star Wars, than can you play, you know, Mahler 9, which I might get to play like once or twice in my career.
That's totally true. I've seen it on a couple audition lists that students of mine have taken. So it might be working its way into the repertoire even more.
I love it. Well, we're coming towards the end of our time. Maestro Irizarry, would you like to introduce our last theme and our last question, please?
I'd like to point out that I've seen several lists, both civilian and military, in which these major solos are coming up. So I believe that this music has indeed entered the consciousness of orchestral leaders in terms of the quality of players that can be selected by listening to these materials. Next question for all our artists. Do you feel, as professional musicians in American orchestras, that this exposition to this music has a negative effect on audiences? Because I've heard that argument from some individuals. I'd like to hear your perspective on this. Is this music bad for the audience?
I mean, any music that gets people in the concert hall is great music. And it's like, if people like it, then, and it uses an orchestra, how is there anything bad with that? And, you know, honestly, I want classical music to relate to everybody. And, you know, if people can relate to a theme from a movie and it uses classical music, then that makes my job twice as easy, because number one, they already know the theme. Number two, now they're familiar with like the classical, you know, genre, and it's not intimidating or scary. And then, you know, then we can gradually expose people to more classical music. But yeah, of course, the best possible thing to happen to our industry.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, yeah, this is some of the most gorgeous music that's out there, and some of the most like exhilarating, and yeah, it touches your soul in all the most amazing ways. Yeah. And also, like you said, David, like, even if you're feeling rather purist about it and you want more people to come to your Mozarts and your Mahlers, it is a fantastic way for people to fall in love with orchestra as an art form, and they will be more likely to come back. So, I mean, even if that's your end goal, you know, it works in that direction as well. But yeah, I mean, it's just stunning even on its own. We don't even need it for anything else but that.
Thank you, Ms. Montone. Benito, we are right. We're not that crazy. Right.
No.
So, Maestro Velez, shall I introduce our final excerpt for this event?
Please, sir, go right ahead.
Mr. Cooper, you honor us by performing Princess Leia's theme from Star Wars: A New Hope. Thank you, sir.
You to keep going. I was like, oh, take the repeat or something. Well. That was great. All of you sound so fantastic. All right, we're coming to the end of our time, but really fast, around the horn for all of you, two quick questions. One, what's your favorite Star Wars character? And two, if there is a child or someone considering playing the French horn, why should they do it? David, favorite character, and why should someone consider playing the horn?
I mean, I love Yoda, but baby Yoda is just like so cute. Come on. Like, he's got those eyes. Yeah, I mean, gotta love baby Yoda. Honestly, the horn for me is one of these things that constantly challenges me and teaches me. So in order to overcome an obstacle on the horn, I have to learn more about myself. You know, how do I focus better? How do I, you know, what can I bring more to the instrument? And truly, it's an everyday challenge that I love. And I've never been bored. And every time I pick it up, I'm fulfilled. You know, it's my voice. So if I can recommend to anyone thinking about an instrument, horn is one of these things that has brought me so much joy in my life and has given me a much better life because of it, you know, with the opportunities, with music. I think anyone on any level can enjoy horn. So I strongly encourage people to pick it up.
Man, I would not want to go after that explanation. But let's go to Jen Montone. Jen, I know if anyone can be even more articulate and be an ever better salesperson for the horn, I know it's you. She's like, quick, buy, if you buy one now, you get one free.
No, I completely agree. No, and I'll go in the same direction. I think it's the, like, if we all want to be lifelong learners and we all also want to be kind of emotionally, you know, able to grow and, you know, change, like playing any instrument is wonderful, but the horn, like just the music that's written for us, it's like this deep well you can just like, you know, get saturated in, and it's just beautiful. And yeah, like you said, there's all these challenges, and it's sort of like, you know, it can help you escape out of your world into this beautiful thing, and then it can also kick your butt and make you want to like try harder and do better and figure more things out. And it's like, it's just really gratifying, and you know, all the one most beautiful, you know, aspects of life, like all wrapped up into a little piece of metal. So I agree.
Well put. And favorite Star Wars character?
Oh, I'm sorry. Obi-Wan.
Obi-Wan. Ooh, all right. Okay. Benito, same question for you. Favorite Star Wars character? And if you had a chance to tell someone why they should play horn, what do you say?
Mine is Luke Skywalker. And then the horn. I think that I cannot sing with my voice because that's horrible. But I can sing, you know, with my instrument, be more expressive. I can do many things with my instrument that I cannot do with my word, you know, and with my voice. So also, I teach my students to, if you love the instrument, you love the music, do the best that you can do, you know, because although if you are not going to study like musician career, at least you are going to be a better person if you play this instrument or another instrument also, because the emotion and many things that you learn when you play an instrument like this. So thank you so much for
invitation also. Thank you all so much for doing this. My tremendous thanks to my co-host, Mr. Rafael Enrique Irizarry, Associate Director of the Puerto Rico Symphony. A big thanks to all of you. Next up, we're going to chat with composer Kevin Kiner for today's release. Star Wars The Bad Batch comes out today on Disney+. We are excited to be back here and continue our conversation with Star Wars Across Generations, Part 2, the French horn of the Star Wars universe, with the wonderful composer, Mr. Kevin Kiner. Kevin, great to see you.
Hey, nice to see you too.
Hey, thanks again for being a part of this. We have so many questions for you, but we've got to get this started off right with some music, because we just finished a conversation with the amazing French horns, which they've kind of thought of themselves, the Star Wars horns. We had a conversation with David Cooper, who's principal French horn of Chicago Symphony, Benito Diaz, principal horn of the Puerto Rico Symphony, Jennifer Montone, principal of the Philadelphia Orchestra, and Jeff Nelsen, who plays horn for the Canadian Brass. So we have a little something for you. Joel, go ahead.
Bravo.
They're good, aren't they?
Yeah, they're great.
Oh, man, that's so cool. Again, big thanks to David Cooper, to Benito Diaz, to Jennifer Montone, and Jeff Nelsen for doing that and for kicking off the latest theme into the Star Wars canon, The Bad Batch, which releases today on Disney+, composed by Mr. Kevin Kiner. So, Kevin, my first to you is, first of all, congratulations on the Annie Award for Best Music for Television, correct?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you very much.
How does that feel? I mean, I know you've been nominated many times before, but especially this was for the final season of the Clone Wars, which was heavily brought back by the audience really wanting this to come back. So it's got to be a pretty big honor. How do you feel about that?
It was beautiful. I mean, it's really a shame that it wasn't, I didn't have my tux on and we weren't at Royce Hall at UCLA, where I've been numerous times before and not received an Annie Award. I was about to go surfing and I was parked at the side of the road putting my suit on, and I saw a text from a friend of mine said, "Hey, you won an Annie Award." I'm like, "Oh, cool." And then I went, got in the water.
That's cool. That's awesome, man. Big congratulations. It is
thank you.
Something very, very well deserved. I mean, obviously, anytime the music of the Star Wars universe is acknowledged, usually that is kind of exclusively to John Williams, and yet this is going directly to you. So huge congratulations, very much well deserved. Maestro Irizarry, next question is for you, sir.
Mr. Kiner, this is such a joy.
Oh, thanks. The pleasure is mine.
You are evidently dealing with 40 years of background for your work now. How do you manage to keep your personality in this music while also respecting previous efforts?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I still struggle with that, actually. I believe I achieve it most of the time. But initially, you know, the job was to sound like John Williams a little bit. I always liken it to when I was learning guitar, and say I learned a guitar solo by a famous guitar player, say it was George Benson or Wes Montgomery or even Jimmy Page or whatever. I would learn that solo note for note. But the goal, and as you know, as an instrumentalist, is not to be able to play that solo every time, note for note. The goal is to kind of get those licks under your fingers, right? And to make that part of your musical vocabulary. And then when I would go and do my own guitar solos, you know, maybe a few of those licks make it into there, or maybe my own interpretation of those notes or whatever come into my solo. But then again, it's my solo and I'm expressing myself, so it's difficult for me to describe how I express myself, but I am conscious about it. I'm always conscious of not being an imitator. I don't want to be mini John, you know. I respect what he's done, and he's the greatest of all time. And it's monumentally wonderful shoulders to stand upon, but I want to do my own thing as well.
That's a wonderful analogy. Thank you for that. Being in essence a guitarist, how do you approach the sound of the horn in terms of the context of your music for this series?
Well, I don't compose on guitar unless I'm doing a piece where I'm going to be playing guitar. I compose on the keyboard or in my head, many times on piano. So, I'm very aware of the range of the French horn. I try not to write above a C concert, above middle C. I mean, I know you guys can play D's and E flats, which is your A and B flat, but I try to the sonority of the horn is kind of, for me, is, you know, the octaves below and above middle C. That's where I love, that's where I feel like the horn lives. So I try to, and that's, you know, that's the great, you know, that's you know, the male and into the female singing voice, you know, that's a beautiful range. So I mean, I do think about the range, and also I mean, the French horn is so, you know, is so married to the sound of what you would call maybe sci-fi music or space music or whatever. It's always, when I was writing Star Trek Enterprise, you know, the big moments were always in the French horns, and the same when John Williams wrote the Force theme, you know, it was a scene called I think Twin Suns, when Luke is looking out over, Binary you know, Sunset. Binary Sunset. That's it. Thank you. You guys are better than me, but you know, that's a solo French horn. And it's one of the great melodies he ever wrote. And it just, and you know, it sits so nicely. He wrote exactly the right key and everything.
You do realize that that particular spot in the original Star Wars film probably determined the professional career of many young players.
Did it?
That particular spot. I believe I'm included amongst those. It changed lives to listen to the horn in that context.
Right, because were you in college or university when you saw Star Wars? Or
I was barely 16, sir. Barely.
Oh, 16. You're younger than me. Excuse me. I forgive you. I forgive me. I mean, yeah. See, I was. I don't know. I was probably just 20, maybe 19 or something. Oh no, 18. Was I 18? 77, huh? Yeah, I was a freshman at UCLA. You know, his music, in the same way the French horn, you know, you heard the French horn and you wanted to do that. I heard his music and I wanted to sound like that. And I'm like, how does he make that sound? What is he doing? You know, it was completely opaque to me. It was like behind a closed door. And I'm like, how the heck does he make that sound?
Exactly by feelings, sir. To me, in a sense, it also was, how the hell do they play like that?
Yeah, there you go.
What does
and
it sound?
By the way, I've heard some very good French horn players clam the Force theme in a concert.
I'd rather not name names, but
no, I'm not naming any names. But you know, you get very nervous if you're names out there. Ah, it's scary, isn't it?
Not here at home, by the way. Our horns have been very, very consistent, but I've seen that's some fantastic accidents. May I ask you, sir, what does the sound of the horn evoke in your sensibilities as an artist?
Well, you know, again, it's in that range around middle C and above and below, and it's such a warm range. It can go quite below middle C, but and there's a sonority whereas, you know, now I'm going to get hate mail from trumpet players, but I mean, a trumpet is very bright and doesn't evoke because the horn has more of a covered sound, especially since it's facing backwards, you know, because I even on my original Clone Wars, that was written for four horns and four Wagner tubas. So I had eight players on there. Yeah. And they were always playing, but even the Wagner tuba is a little too bright, you know, or it's a little too edgy, you know? And so there's just a warmth to the sound of the French horn and, you know, the greatest illustration is the Force theme, because it has a character, it has a soul, but it's not too bright, but it's not too dark either, you know, and now I'm keenly aware that you're playing very high on the harmonic the overtone scale, you know, so I know that you guys have to deal with a very unwieldy instrument that is not always wanting to play the exact pitch that it's supposed to, right? But in a way, when you're wrestling with that, it it kind of gives, you know, with a little lip into a note or a little slur, there's a character to it that just gives it a marvelous soul. I don't know how else to describe it, because in those slurs and while you're wrestling with keeping it in tune and whatever you're doing as a horn player, and you probably, as you get very good, you don't wrestle as hard, but there's something about the way the notes, instead of just playing do, do, do three notes, you guys go do, you know, and there's just a nice transition between the notes. And then you can, you know, you can really light it up, by which I mean you can really open up the sound, you know, so at the end of a note, you can really crescendo and give lots of brashness, which again, so I think it's a very emotional instrument. Soul is the best description I have for it.
Which do you prefer, the sound of the unison horn section or the harmonized horn section, and why?
Oh man, that's like, you know, naming your favorite child. I love the fact that I can write for both of those things. You know, so if I really want to really drive home a melody, you know, so I got six guys who are like, you know, I've got, you know, four horns and four Wagner tubas playing a unison line is pretty fun too. You know, it's this very brash and you know, and there's a character in that. So I love doing unison lines with a big section, but I also love harmonies. I mean, when I write a string melody, and I mean, so many composers, John Barry was so famous for this, where he had the trombones down low and he had the French horns down low as well, harmonizing, you know, with these just full major chords and triads, and then a beautiful string melody, like Out of Africa or whatever it was, you know, wow, the horns are doing it. You're just anchoring the harmony, so I love that too. So I don't have a favorite.
And if I may, one final question, sir. What are your feelings regarding the permanence of this music after almost 50 years of it being around? Why did that happen?
I believe that happened because John Williams is rooted in classicism and he doesn't follow the flavor of the month, whether that be electronic or whether that be in the style. If you listen to some old film scores, you know, all the brass are playing in mutes, all the horns are stopped, you know, and they're going, and it sounds really dated. I mean, even great composers like Bernard Herrmann, Max Steiner, Miklos Rozsa, those scores can sound kind of dated because, you know, they had that style which was the zeitgeist of that time, and it was in the culture of that time. John stayed away from that. He stayed in a pure classicism, you know, and so that his music could have been written by Stravinsky. It could have been written by Tchaikovsky. It could have been written even by Beethoven. You know, it spans the centuries. And I believe that's why. And I really am conscious of that when I'm writing my melodies as well, because there's a sophistication that you want to bring to it. But also there's a simplicity in the melody, and those are very difficult to combine. You know, it's very difficult not to get too complicated, it's difficult to write a simple melody that is not trite and pedantic or whatever also. So it's a really fine line, and he does it better than anyone who's ever lived in film music.
Mr. Kiner, thank you so very much. Maestro Velez, back to you, sir.
Kevin, one quick question before we got to let you go. So again, congratulations today on May 4th releases on Disney Plus, The Bad Batch. And as we heard leading into this was The Bad Batch theme, played by as you know, David Cooper, principal horn of the Chicago Symphony, calls it the Star Wars horns. I love that. Can you tell us anything about the Bad Batch or how you perhaps chose to have this new theme and these new characters with the horn? Or can you tell us anything about the Bad Batch, what we can expect with this new show musically?
You know, I wish my eldest son, Sean, was here because he was very instrumental in the composition of the Bad Batch theme. And I have to give him credit for that. He is my co-composer on that. But, you know, we wanted, this was a group, and they showed up in Clone Wars. So I'm not, you know, when I do interviews before this came out, we could talk about the Bad Batch. But there was kind of they're sort of heroic misfits, you know, and one of the models that Dave Filoni gave us was like the Dirty Dozen or Kelly's Heroes or Guns of Navarone, where these guys, they have specialized skills and they're really amazing, but they're kind of a band of misfits and the heroic nature of them, because in the end, ultimately, even though they are misfits, they are heroic and their heart is tremendous. So you want to have something, and the brass, you know, in general, and especially the French horns, playing that kind of a melody is just, that's like kind of a no-brainer, you know, to do that. So, you know, that's where, there's some other cool themes coming out too. I hope everybody likes them. There's some very iconic new characters in Bad Batch.
Well, I'm really excited. I know my son, Lewis, is excited to check it out too.
Right on.
Huge congratulations on Bad Batch. Thank you again for your time and for being part of this conversation about the French horn in the Star Wars universe. Before we let you go, we have a little special gift for you. Joel, pull it up. It's a special gift from our friends at the Canadian Brass.
Happy Star Wars Day, everyone. Kevin Kiner, this is for you.
Thank you everyone who took the time out to learn that chart and to do that arrangement and the one before that played earlier. Thank you guys. It's just fantastic. And I've got to play this for Sean because he'll go berserk. I mean, you know. Well,
special thanks to you for writing it, and special thanks to Ryan Beard for the great arrangement, to our friends.
Yeah, Ryan, great David job, Cooper, man.
To special thanks to Benito, Diaz, to Jennifer Montone, to Jeffrey Nelsen, and to the rest of the Canadian Brass, and my little...
He just got photobombed.
Right.
Video bombed. Yes.
All right, Kevin, thanks so much. We appreciate it. Happy Star Wars Day.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, sir. So I have three themes we're going to have played. We're going to start off first with the principal hornist of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra, Mr. Benito Diaz, who's going to play for us the force theme. And then I'd love to hear your thoughts on perhaps how you encountered that and any way that you may have adjusted it, orchestrated it, etc. So Maestro Diaz, could you please play for us the force theme? Thank you, sir. So I'm really curious, as you have for each of you, and there's no particular order for this, what has been your experience with the force theme and how you have worked with it? Let's go to Bill Ross, Mr. Ross.
Well, it's a spectacular theme, and that's one of the advantages of having these all these great themes. I've when we did the Galaxy's Edge music, adapting all of John's or a lot of John's music for the new theme park that Disney built, there's three attractions that I worked on, and we use the force theme regularly to convey the right emotion, whatever it was. There's such a sense of nobility, but also a hauntingness, a desire in it, a hope that something like that exists. So it's you can use that theme in such great areas, and we did that all through Galaxy's Edge quite nicely.
On flute is Josue Casillas, who can play Princess Leia's theme. Can you hear that real quick, please? Nicely done, sir. Thank you very much. Gosh, all of you sound so great. I'll head back to Conrad on this one, Princess Leia's theme. I know you have a lot of experience with many of these, but in particular, Princess Leia's theme. I don't know if there's anything you want to share about your experience with Leia's theme, or this is, again, for anyone, too.
We just talked about how beautiful this particular theme is extraordinarily beautiful. And there's a lot to say that I could probably babble on and on and on, but I would say for anyone is that what's great about John's themes is that it's so rich. It does have a beginning, a middle, and an end. You clearly know when the theme opens up the space and keeps growing, as Gordy was saying about the force theme, of how it reaches a distinct climax, both in terms of its harmony as well as its range. It also builds up tension, and also each bit of the theme can be extracted and used as another sort of motif that you can keep building upon. And the only other thing, it's easy enough to know the themes. The thing that I would say, thinking about being here today, it's always what's underneath this that is so magnificent. And what John conceives of as the accompaniment and as the orchestration, and how different the orchestration is, say, between the first three, and then the next three, and then the last three. But I'm just always amazed at how he finds to find the perfect way to set the jewel of the theme in this crown of the orchestra and everyone else. And what's so amazing that if you're in the orchestra, maybe the members of the orchestra can bear this out. If you're playing one of these things, you don't have to be playing the theme to feel like you're playing something important and something that's contributing to the overall direction of the music. And that's what's remarkable about this as a musician, is that in John's hands, there's not an unimportant part. And so everybody, when you hear this theme and you play along with it, you know exactly how you fit with it and how you're supporting it and how you're making it go. And so that's my two cents about that, though. I could, like I said, I could go on forever.
the concertmaster of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra, Mr. Omar Velasquez, who's going to play for us Yoda's theme, please. Bravo, sir. Bravo. Bravo. Oh, what a fabulous orchestra. Oh, my goodness. Great musicians. So we have to kind of hit with Yoda's theme here before we chat about it. We are delighted to have a brief cameo appearance here from one of the original modelers of Yoda himself. Joining us from the Virgin Islands, Mr. Nick Maley. Nick, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Ah, Nick, thank you so much for joining us. And I see you have someone there over your shoulder. And can you tell us a bit about him?
Yeah, he's keeping an eye on me, making sure that I don't do anything stupid, right? You know, he doesn't like things that are stupid. He kind of escaped from his hovel just for this event because he's a fan of the music too.
Nice. I had the pleasure of meeting you, Nick, back in November. When Mr. Williams had very generously given an autographed score page to the orchestra for a future fundraising event, and I was ecstatic to meet you. You know, most known now as simply as the Yoda guy, and what a very special treat to kind of go backstage in Maestro Irizarry's dressing room and see this massive, really heavy, expensive-looking piece of luggage, and inside was Yoda himself. Now, sir, that's not the original Yoda, is it? I imagine the decades gone by, there'd have to be some sort of wear and tear. Can you tell us about it?
All the original Yodas fell apart about 25 years ago. You know, Yoda, to try and get a lot of expression out of him, his skin is very soft and flexible. Yeah, it's like your skin won't look the same in 40 years either. So, yeah, you know, you just have to get used to that. So when they started making Yoda into a digital character, for my little museum in the Caribbean, I just decided that I would remake him. And this latest version is made from relics, from the molds that we made back in 1979. Relics that came out that then reverse engineered to remake the molds. So I'm kind of very, very happy with him. I'd like to correct one thing though. I wasn't the original sculptor. The original sculptor was my boss, Stuart, who was largely my mentor, Stuart Freeborn. He was the old man of creature effects at that time. And when we made the first movie, I was, you know, the young guy on the team. But by the time we'd done Superman and Superman 2, came back to Empire Strikes Back, I was one of the senior techs. And as time went by, they needed more than one version of Yoda. And so while Stu was working on what we thought was going to be the primary version, I ended up making another three with some other people who were also Yoda guys. The lady from the Muppets was very important. Wendy Midner, she made all the bodies the same way as Miss Piggy and sculpted the hands and other things. My work was really on the head.
Well, it is incredibly impressive, and I am thrilled that you could join us. So I know you got it going, but please stay safe, stay healthy, be well, and I very much look forward to the next time our paths get to cross, and thank you for joining us this evening.
Oh, you are very welcome. And it's been a joy to listen to all of these talented musicians and to get their insight into how all of this comes about and how these themes relate to each other. I think that's one of the things about Star Wars. It's absolutely true that John Williams's music was absolutely key to making this. And these individual themes, the Force theme particularly, Princess Leia as well, and Yoda's theme, they all have a charisma that is hard to kind of escape from, whether they're played by a full orchestra or by a guy, you know, on one instrument. They still capture a sense of magic that is special to all of us non-musicians as well.
Very cool. Nick, thank you very much for joining us. And again, look forward to seeing you again. Take care, sir.
Yeah, take care.
I want to move on to the next question. And before I do that, though, for regarding the first three prequel episodes, I know we have the principal harpist, Miss Elisa Torres, who can play for us the Across the Stars theme before we segue into Mr. Gordy Haab. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I'm going to, in the sake of time, I'm going to kind of go ahead and combine a little bit of Gordy Haab and Kevin Kiner to this next one here. Maestro Melendez, I believe you probably have the Battlefront theme from Gordy Haab on piano there. Could you go ahead and play that for us, please, and kind of kick off our conversation with Mr. Gordy Haab?
Yes.
Thank you, sir, very much. Gordy, what a beautiful theme. So, Gordy, I was listening to a podcast recently, and I heard that you kind of came into the Star Wars universe kind of as a fan at first, and that's how you got into this. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of correct. So I just moved to Los Angeles and was getting into film scoring and actually worked with a young filmmaker who made a Star Wars fan film. It was just him and one other guy fighting with lightsabers for a couple minutes and in their street clothes. You know, it wasn't really even Star Wars themed other than the fact that they had lightsabers. But I ended up writing the music for this, and some folks at LucasArts had heard the music and were looking for a composer for an Indiana Jones video game, and then later a Star Wars video game. And because of this music that I had written for this little 5-minute, two nerds fighting with their lightsabers, one thing led to the next, and I sort of found my way into working in the Star Wars music world.
I have to ask the obvious question, and I come from this purely as a fan perspective. How intimidating is that to recognize? And then Kevin, you can chime on after this one, but to then be given the opportunity, but I can almost imagine it's a bit of a curse to say, all right, here's John Williams, your predecessor. good luck to you. Here's the deadline, and we look forward to seeing what amazing stuff you will create for us.
It's crippling. I'll say that. the fear of that. But also sort of inspiring. I liked the challenge, and I saw it as an opportunity to sort of put my own stamp on things musically, or at least, you know, put my own spin on the very things that sort of inspired me to get into music in the first place, which, you know, John Williams' music is probably the number one influence in my early musical development. So yes, certainly intimidating, but also a really, you know, a great challenge and an honor.
Now, I'm really curious, and Kevin, can you actually chime on that? What was your first experience like when you got this for the Clone Wars movie back in 2008, and which was kind of a pivotal moment here in the Star Wars canon, because the prequel happened, the original movies had happened, and now clearly Mr. Lucas was wanting to go in a different direction and also being animated. What was that experience for you, and were you given specific direction to go in?
I was given some direction. The first thing I had to do was to rearrange the main title. And I argued vigorously with George Lucas about that, because I said, you know, John Williams did this correctly the first time, and it really doesn't need to be rearranged. But, you know, George wanted it to be, and he wanted drums and things like that. And it was kind of crippling. But just like Gordy said, it's also a great opportunity. I use a sports analogy sometimes. It's, I'll see great sports figures interviewed before the game or their event, and the interviewer will ask them, "Are you nervous?" And they'll sometimes say no, or just excited, or whatever. And if you're going to step up, and if you're going to be better, and if you're going to up your game, you have to have a level of nervousness. You have to be afraid a bit, but you also have to have the confidence that you're up to the task. And I mean, for me, I felt it made me better than I'd ever been.
Mr. Diaz, if you are there, could you play for us Ahsoka's theme, please, on French horn? Thank you very much. I'd love to hear Mr. Diaz one more time, the principal hornist of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra, play the recently released Bad Batch theme, which I know currently is available, I believe, on Amazon Music and iTunes. So let's hear the Bad Batch theme. Oh, bravo, sir. Bravo. Okay. So in interest of time, because I still want to give us some time for those who are still watching right now, if you have any questions in about roughly 10 minutes or a little less, we're going to come over to your questions that you might have for our panel here, and to make sure we can get out of here as close as possible to our hour limit. So I'll turn back over to my co-host, Maestro Irizarry, for your questions for Mr. Ross in his immense experience here with the Star Wars franchise.
Mr. Ross, if I may be so bold, I'm sure that I can be the spokesperson for many, many, many people. What was it like to be in that final recording session for Star Wars?
Oh, well, I don't even know where to begin with all of that. It was heartfelt and overwhelming to think that that would be the last time that Maestro Williams would be doing that. But, you know, you never say never. So who am I to say it's the last time? But should it be, what a phenomenal gift that he's given to our culture. The nine films are just a staggering achievement, probably the greatest achievement in film music, I would think, over a long period of time, with the bar set so phenomenally high. Every bar practically is just spectacular. So, you know, I don't know how to properly add to that that concept, but anyway.
May I ask, because this is another question that has turned up on occasion. People wonder when they see these videos in which the actual actors visit the recording sessions, does that mean to us outsiders that there's some sort of input given by the actors on the sort of music that they're going to get? Are there any conversations on what they like, what they dislike, or are they just there as witnesses?
Well, I'm not privy to those conversations. All I see is in the recording studio that they come, and all I've seen is that they come to just be overwhelmed. Daisy Ridley came and she spent all day during the last film, Rise of Skywalker. She was also there during Force Awakens, as was John Boyega and Mark Hamill. And they just come and they're overwhelmed by it. It was interesting. John was on the podium and he turned around and Mark Hamill was standing there. It was just one of those moments like, oh, look who's joined us. Here is Luke Skywalker standing there. So it's really phenomenal. But
I know in my experiences, the actors, I've met quite a few of the voice actors for Clone Wars and Rebels. They don't usually have direct input, but they do in their acting. You know, when you watch them on screen, or I'm listening to them because it's their voices in animation, but their emotions inspire us and the melodies we write.
One final question, if I may. In contrast with work done in the earlier films, it seems that the process for this later trilogy was a little bit more protracted. There was more time to work on the music and to do the recording. The question is, was it a little bit more comfortable in contrast to previous occasions in which some of this work was done in a little bit of haste in terms of assembling the orchestra and recording 2 hours of music in a very short period of time?
Well, again, you'd have to ask John Williams. I'm not privy to all of that. I know that I think that in the last three movies, the evolution of the ability to make cuts, you know, the very quickly, it's a digital world and people are constantly making cuts. So that may have something to do. I'm not saying it does, but that may have something to do with it. The desire to get pieces of music and put them into the film as the cutting process goes may have something to do with it. But again, you'd have to ask John. I can't imagine it's a thrill to write under. Well, I know it's not a thrill to write under that kind of pressure. So I think having a lot of time is great.
Thank you, Mr. Ross.
You know, I got to interject here a second, Bill, because I mean, when you read about how quickly he wrote New Hope, and that's, you know, maybe the greatest theme he ever wrote is the Force theme. And he was under such pressure. And I know for myself personally, sometimes stream of consciousness is better, even though it beats you up physically and emotionally and mentally with a time crunch. I mean, sometimes for me, too much time is not as good. I don't know what it's like for John, but it's just a personal thing for myself.
Thank you so very much, sir. Thank you so very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, Maestro Velez.
I know, Mr. Ross, while you're still here, we were chatting the other day about one of these great new, you know, themes that come out, and it's the Kylo Ren theme, and kind of how it's gone from the bad theme kind of to the good theme. And if I just, we have the principal trombonist of the orchestra, Mr. Jerry Rivas. Mr. Rivas, could you play for us the Kylo Ren bad theme?
course.
Thank you, sir, very much. So, Mr. Ross, you had mentioned that there was a bit of a difference how that theme was projected in demonstrating Kylo Ren, kind of the bad character versus kind of his redemption good character. Do you want to kind of share a little bit about that?
Well, I think it's incredibly brilliant. And again, it just goes to the genius of John Williams. Now, I'm not positive about this, but it's my understanding that in Force Awakens, you know, they weren't exactly sure where the franchise was going to go. So Kylo Ren was bad, really bad. And John wrote a theme that works perfect for this bad guy. And then I remember in Rise of Skywalker that they were having a talk about, you know, we need to take Kylo's theme and turn it into this poignant desire. You know, it's like you're going to resurrect Kylo as more of a good guy. And so you had to take this theme that was written completely from the perspective of he's all bad and turn it around. And we were all interested to see what John would come up with. And it just stunned me. He primarily did it through a different harmonization, but he only slightly changed the melody. And it was just brilliant. I mean, really, really great. It's hard to hear it with one instrument because where the difference comes in is how he harmonizes it. And so anyway, that's pretty amazing.
Very cool. Where the last thing we're gonna kind of talk about in this kind of Star Wars canon is the Mandalorian theme. And if we could get onto that with Mr. Casillas, the principal flutist of the Puerto Rico Symphony, could you please play for us the Mandalorian theme? Thank you, sir, very much, very much. All right, so before we dive into questions, I do want to hit up the kind of one of the latest things. Obviously, we have Star Wars The Clone Wars currently out, Jedi Fallen Order out, Rise of Skywalker recently out, as well as The Mandalorian. And I know Ludwig Göransson wasn't able to join us today, but thanks to the kindness of Disney, we had planned on doing the world premiere of the Mandalorian theme for orchestra with the orchestra today. Unfortunately, we couldn't, but I was so excited that when Kevin pulled out the bass recorder, which is not the most common instrument, but in me doing this orchestration and some research, which is why I put on an alto flute. Luckily, the lowest pitch was a G, so it worked out really nicely. Had that slight, airy yet resonant sound to it, but that the bass recorder was there also kind of before The Mandalorian. So a quick final question to Mr. Kiner. Why did you use bass recorder out of this massive palette of instruments you can go for? And I know that you mentioned Mr. Lucas wanted to have different sonorities representing different planets, but why did you particularly use the bass recorder for Ahsoka's theme?
You know, I have well over 100 instruments over here, so it may have been the one that caught my eye that day or something. I'd like to say it was a brilliant stroke of genius. Yeah,
you were tying, you were setting up the Mandalorian live. Yeah, okay.
But it is an instrument I can play. I played it. I had to stitch some notes together.
Can you play it for us?
Yeah. Well, I'm going to blow it now. Mm-hmm. Is that enough? Yeah.
Very nice.
It's really low and woody sounding, and and I'm able to play it. That's probably the reason.
So it's a good reason. Okay. So we're going to our last few minutes here, and I know we have some questions that have been coming in. So Reuven Herman is our tech guy here. Let's see, we have a question here. What is the vital essence of Star Wars music? Wow, that seems like a really easy question. So let's go first with Mr. Gordy Haab. What is the vital essence of Star Wars music to you?
It seems like an easy question, but it's actually pretty difficult. I would say that the essence of it is leitmotif. It really does define every character in the film, and much like a sort of operatic style of composing music. Developing these themes over the course of, nine films, it really has become sort of this, symphonic masterpiece due to the leitmotifs and the individual theme character themes.
Very cool. Reuven, let's pull up another question.
Yeah, well, Reuven was doing that. I was going to say melody. So, the same thing that Gordy says.
Oh, absolutely. The melody is iconic, and as Gordy mentioned, those leitmotifs that set up everything else that you kind of in that operatic sense can come back to, build off of, reference, etc. Question for Mr. Conrad Pope. As composers and orchestrators, what is the single most important thing we should take to our hearts from the music of Star Wars?
Work harder. No, I actually kind of mean that. That you should, look, I think one of the things is that extraordinary range in every emotion, in every possible thing. The formal identity, you could spend a lifetime studying this, okay, as far as I'm concerned. Luckily, I don't have much of a lifetime left, so I'm not going to say too much of it. But I will tell you this, is that I think that as composers and orchestrators, it's the fundamental things, is that fundamentals. If you can do anything for yourself as a composer, John Williams knows the absolute fundamentals of music making. This is something that people don't concentrate on too much today. But if you can just sort of, there's nothing, as John once wrote somebody, I think, study it and see how the accompaniments are made, because generally, like I tell people think orchestration is instrumentation. No, it's not instrumentation. It's what you write for those instruments and understanding the notion of those instruments and understanding why is the Princess Leia theme great in the horn? Or why is it great in the flute? Or why is it great in the violin? And what keys do you pick? And also, how do you find these accompaniments? And how does rhythm work? One of the few things that we can talk about is certainly pitch, but rhythm in John Williams is key to keeping that thing developing and moving straight ahead and along. And so there's so much that we can all learn from that, but it's really basically fundamentals and see how those fundamentals are executed by a master. And we can all learn fundamentals. We all can't be masters, but the first step to being able to be a master is mastering the fundamentals. That would be my answer. It's not very hopeful, but hopefully.
Yeah. Well, it seems that the music of Star Wars is certainly sets the precedence for very large shoes to fill for anyone that dares to tackle it, or certainly even contemplate adding to it.
I'll just quickly add is that John's grandson was studying with me, sent him over, and he brought over, Ethan did, John's Getch's book of harmony that was extraordinarily well notated by a very young John Williams in a very neat hand. And so John is somebody that is not only a master of music, but clearly a very serious student of it too. John, that's also good for all of us.
I love that, a lifelong student. For Bill and or Conrad, do either of you have a cue or section of music that you received from Mr. Williams that stands out as particularly brilliant or memorable in some way? Let's go to Mr. Ross. Is there a particular cue or section of music that you've received that stands out particularly for you?
The first to the last. It's like I said earlier, it's every bar is just seemingly brilliant. To me, Princess Leia's theme, as it's constructed for the concert hall, is almost a perfect piece of music. The arc of it, every piece of music starts, has an event to it, and then it finishes. So that arc can be extremely short if it's a staccato eighth note, or it can be long, you know, like a symphony. But the arc of Princess Leia's theme is so spectacular, the way it builds and builds. And then to get to that unbelievable B major cadence is just, it's one of my favorite cadences in all of music, any music anywhere. I think that's just a absolute masterpiece. But, you know, another one to me is the way he took Yoda's theme and used it for Yoda himself or herself or itself. Nick, help me. And anyway, and then the way he used it when Yoda raises the ship up out of the swamp, it's absolutely spectacular. And then he gets to that brass stuff that is just unbelievable. So, you know, those are high points.
Very cool. Mr. Pope, same question to you. Is there a particular cue or moment that really sticks out to you personally or professionally?
Well, quite a few, but like Bill. But the one I'll pick out was just Duel of the Fates. I remember when we got the score to that, the sketch to that, and it went on and on and on. And with the... Remember, Neufeld and I looked at each other and we thought, this is either going to be the dumbest piece of music ever or the most brilliant. Because when you have these things, and of course, this is before, you know, any of the mock-ups, and you're sitting there, you're playing through this stuff at the piano. And it's one of those things that we were going, let's see how this turns out. And it was, and of course, you know, it's absolutely a knockout and set the tone for so much. And the E minor and all that is played out endlessly, even in what we're in the heartbeat today. And so that's what stood out. There are just, because trust me, there are very few moments when anything arrives at your door from John Williams where you go like, huh? But that was one, because it was so insistent. So that's a, and proving again, like I said, I can't predict the future. And the rest is history, namely how they cut the thing up, because that's another interesting story, is that it was composed in a different way than it appears in the movie. So that's always special.
As we close up here, I want to bring our last questions actually to the members of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra. And before I do forget, my sincerest appreciation to all of you for playing these excerpts and playing them so beautifully. And on a personal note, for sharing that beauty in a time where a lot of us need those concerts. We need that time to hear music. And all of you have played so beautifully. So my appreciation to you. But my last question, I'd love to get your thoughts of all of you from a professional concert perspective. What has the music of Star Wars meant to you? And I'm going to start here in score order. So the principal flutist, Mr. Josue Casillas, what has the music of Star Wars meant to you, sir?
It was primarily a technical challenge. I played in high school bands and orchestra. So it's very exciting from an instrumentalist perspective, very exciting music to play, very cohesive, very tonal. It's amazing. It's in the crux of what any flutist would love to play. So it was an integral part of my development, yes.
Very cool. Same question to Principal Hornist, Mr. Benito Diaz. What is the music of Star Wars meant to you? Oh, I think you're on mute still, sir.
There is. Okay.
There you go.
I think that... I don't know how many home players around the world have been, you know, playing this instrument because of Star Wars music, you know, like I used to practice that by ear before starting at the Conservatory of Music in Puerto Rico. I remember playing the Princess Leia theme. My favorite is Luke and Leia theme that I used to play every day, like by memory, you know. And I guess many, many home players are playing this instrument because of Star Wars music, thanks to Mr. Maestro John Williams.
Very cool. And I know there's going to be a resurgence of the bass recorder in schools now, thanks to Ludwig and to Kevin. The same question, please. Heading out to trombone, Mr. Jerry Rivas, the principal trombonist of the orchestra. What has the music of Star Wars meant to you? And before I get to that, sir, I had in my phone that had one of the little memories of, you may remember this. And I recall because a year ago, we had done the premiere of the Clone Wars Suite for Orchestra, and you actually created a little video to send to Kevin Kiner because you actually had been very familiar of the music of the Clone Wars and the fan. So I'd love to hear, what is the music of Star Wars meant to you, sir?
Well, from the start, when I start, learn music, when I was doing my bachelor, and when I get this soundtrack of the Attack of Clones Across the Stars, that blood theme for me, it was very special, you know, in a way that I start to hear the notes, every note. That was the first time. That's like a special, situation for me, because that was the first time that I was hearing the notes, every note with that theme. And, you know, I think that's the special thing about, for me, in my experience with this music of Star Wars.
Very cool, sir. Thank you very much. And the same question to our last three here. For Mr. Melendez, what an honor it is to have you play this amazing music. How has the music of Star Wars played a part in your musical experience?
I have the opportunity to play the most beautiful music with the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra, conducting Maestro Irizarry, conducting Maestro Velez too. And this is an opportunity to me to play. I enjoy every 16th note. Every 16th note, I enjoy the beautiful sound. And that music moves my heart and moves my soul. Every note, if I play this, in my harmony class at the Conservatory of Music in Puerto Rico, sometimes I play some part of Jurassic Park to show the student the importance of the inversion in the chord, 6-6-4. I say, listen to this sound. Without inversion. And they know the importance of the inversion, 64. And this is a beautiful example, Mr. John Williams, Jurassic Park, that the student, they have to know, it's not the same. And in other words, it's a perfect opportunity to play that beautiful, beautiful music with the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra and with my student. But I repeat, I enjoy every 16th note of that music.
I love that. What a very eloquent answer, sir. Thank you. To our last, to the principal harpist of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra, Miss Elisa Torres, can you share with us your thoughts on how the music of Star Wars has played any kind of influence in your musical life?
Well, I love the music because it's very dynamic and it's very emotional. And I also appreciate how he uses the harp a lot. Which many times we are not included in the orchestration. So I'm very happy that I could play in many, many of the selections. So in my case, I fell in love with the music and then I went to see the movies, which I had not seen. So for me, that was very special because music first, and then I went to tie everything that I knew from the music with the movies.
That's I got to say, as a really novice orchestrator in standing in the midst of these giants of Conrad and Bill, you as a professional, it is so easy to write very ignorantly for that beautiful, amazing instrument. And as my son likes to randomly remind me, Daddy, it has 47 strings and 7 pedals. I was like, I can't begin to understand how that works. And he's 5 and he knows more about the harp than I do. But how, ignorantly one can write for, yet someone like John and Bill and Conrad and everyone here can really understand how it works and how it can function very beautifully. My goodness, and thank you for playing so well. As we end here, I would love to get our thoughts from Mr. Omar Velasquez, the concertmaster of the Puerto Rico Symphony Orchestra. The same question to you, sir. What is this music in your musical career? How has that influenced you?
Well, when the first movie got out, I was like 9 years old, so I had the privilege of seeing all the movies in the theater. And of course, the music was really engaging. I didn't know I was going to end up playing it a few years after. But definitely, it draws people more to the classical music and the orchestral sound than other stuff. And it's music that is really from the heart. And when you play and you see the connection with many people that then go back to see the orchestra and hear the sound of the orchestra. So it's just a win-win situation with this music. You enjoy it playing it, people enjoy it, listening to it, and it's wonderful, yeah.
Well, I thank you, sir, for sharing that. We are definitely out of time. All of you have been so generous to hang with us an extra 30 minutes. I am so grateful for all of you for sharing of your time and sharing of your talents and of this music. I wish that, you know, we certainly could have been there in person to play this music and to share it with our closest friends in a 4,000 of our closest friends in the new Coca-Cola Music Hall. But I very much look forward to the chance to coming back to San Juan and to sharing that with all of you and with Maestro Irizarry. The orchestra has a very dear, special place in my heart. I was sharing with someone before we got started live that one of the pieces that you guys had done last was the Incredibles 2, the end credits from the Incredibles 2, a chart that was never intended to go beyond the walls of the studios here in Los Angeles, and your orchestra just nailed it. The style, the spirit of it, and as a conductor, knowing that that I get to rehearse things that are artistic and nothing technical because your orchestra is just comprised of wonderful musicians who make it so delightful to work with. Thank you all for your time. Maestro Irizarry, I'd like to turn it over to you. Before we all go, share my appreciation.
Again, my deepest respect and admiration to the group of artists that I have the privilege of joining this afternoon.
All right. So in interest of time, I know that we all have the music of Star Wars in our hearts, say the least. And I know that we are all having to find new ways to use these online platforms. So we'll just go ahead and share my sincerest appreciation to all of you as we are singing Anakin's theme and the Princess Leia's themes in our hearts. Thank you to everyone. And for those of you on YouTube Live, thanks for joining this and for joining us on Star Wars Across Generations. And we look forward to sharing information when the Orchestra Administration can have this rescheduled at a time that it is best for all of us to regroup and share with our closest 4,000 friends. Until then, all of you, please stay safe, stay inside, and stay healthy. Be well. And we'll talk to you later. Thank you, everyone. Bye. I love it.
There you go. Something.
Thank you all.
Hello. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Hey, there's
Hey! The party continues. Just the party. Go ahead and play.
What?
Go ahead and play.
Okay.
I'm going to play now.
All right.
Anakin's theme. Ready? Thank you.
Bravo.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. Great seeing all of you. Stay safe, take care, be well, stay inside. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.